now rocking with the best. Who's the boxing shoulders knocking out the competition? The kick-ass podcast that make you want to listen. The place where boxing fans and fighters rejoice. Thumbs up for Richie, you're listening to the fighter's voice. It's the brightest choice. If you want all the insights on all the big fights right before the big night. Backstage news, exclusive interviews, and predictions on the fights, who will win or lose. No other show comes close, and you know it's true. Every fighter got a voice, and so do you. Now you're tuned into TFV. It's the Fighter's Voice with Richard Ortiz. Let's go.
Rich Ortiz here with the Fighter's Voice, the only voice that matters. I'm here with four division world champion Mikey Garcia here at Robert Garcia's Boxing Academy. Another day at the office for Mikey Garcia. Tell us about today's workout.
Just like you said, you know, another day at the office. You know, we got some good sparring today, six rounds. You know, like I was telling you earlier, you know, all of last year, I took all of last year off. So just to get back in shape, you know, I started getting back in the gym earlier this year, kind of like late January. So I've been here for a few months now, 3 months or so, and now I feel good. I feel like I can actually start looking for an actual date for a fight, and my body's already adjusted to the work routine, the sparring, you know. So I'm active again. I felt good. Felt good to get back in better shape again and look for a fight now.
You know, like I told you before this interview, I mean, you look good at 147. I mean, the muscles in the right place. You look fit. Is that a transition from just that year, or have you been doing some workouts behind everybody's back, man?
No, I think, you know, having all that time to adjust and to gain weight in muscle mass in the right areas, I think it did help. First fight at 147, you know, 2019 against Spence, it might have been a little too soon, but I mean, that's fine. That's what I did. That's, you know, what I decided to do at that time. And I did feel slow and sluggish in the fight. I think it was maybe a little too soon, but that's all right. You know, you learn from the experiences. Last year, like I said, I actually took the year off, but I mean, I guess gaining that weight might have actually helped, because right now I actually feel a lot better. I feel fast, I feel strong. I mean, you saw some of the work around sparring. I have my footwork, I have my reflexes, I have my movement. So I think, you know, overall, you know, with a little bit of the strength training that I've been doing with Charles and just developing the body into good physical shape has allowed me to, you know, maybe carry the weight a little bit better than I did, you know, 2 years ago.
You know, I know we talked about possible matchups numerous times on the podcast radio show. You know, but I noticed you were still working with the Southpaw. Any hopes on the Manny Pacquiao fight coming through, or do we have our eyes on possibly Sean Porter?
We've been looking into trying to secure a fight with Manny. It hasn't happened. You know, a lot of things, a lot of factors, you know, come into play, and a lot of people come into play for a big fight like that. So it's hard getting all the pieces aligned, you know. But that's what we've been working. You know, as my brother and my nephew hold the mitts, they're in a Southpaw stance. I'm sparring a kid who's also a Southpaw. Just in case that fight does come to fruition, we actually are prepared, you know, and we already did some work behind the scenes, you know, to get in shape, you know, to be prepared for a Southpaw like Manny. If it doesn't happen, we don't lose anything. It's always good to practice, always good to be in shape and to be prepared for whatever opponent we decide to take, you know. So that's what we've been working, you know, fighting, you know, sparring and in a fight stance against the Southpaw.
Talk about preparation and being prepared. I don't think there's anything on this earth to be prepared for taking a ride with Mikey Garcia. Let's talk about that road trip, so to speak, with your brother, man. How did that go down, and how did you maneuver him to get inside your fast car?
Yeah, that, I mean, everybody keeps asking about that video. A lot of people had a good laugh watching my brother scream like a baby. Look, it's funny because, like, I mean, everybody knows, you know, it's nothing new. I mean, I have, you know, some pretty cool cars that I like to take to the track and have fun with them. However, that day my brother was at the house and we were testing out a new product on the car to help acceleration. It allows the car to, you know, take off faster. And I'm trying it out right there in my driveway. And I told Robert, hey, watch, check this out. This is actually a pretty cool thing. Fucking makes the car go faster, like on the launch.
Yeah.
And he had never been in the car with me. He had never wanted to. That day, he said, all right, fuck it, let's go in there. Fine, let's go. So I got him in the car. I took a couple passes right there in my driveway. But now that he was in the car, I'm like, oh, I'm going to take him down on a longer drive. And it's a private road. It's not a big deal. No cars up there. I mean, it's my long driveway, basically.
Right.
So I got on it, and it wasn't even going that fast, but because of the acceleration, that momentum pushed him back. He felt it was going super fast. It really wasn't. The fastest I actually took the car was like 80, 85, which is not that fast, but it was the short distance that it went, you know, that he felt it. And then, of course, there's some turns and whatnot that he felt like we're going 100 and we're going like 35, 40. But, I mean, he's never experienced anything like that. So he was almost crying. He was screaming. The full video is like a four-minute video that I got, because I got him on two occasions. And it was very funny. My dad was mad at first, but then we got my sisters on it. And then my dad kind of relaxed. So he saw that everybody was having fun. And, I mean, it's not like it's my first time driving, and I never drive fast. I never do that on the streets. I'll never do that. That's dumb. That's stupid. But I do take it to the track, so I have experience driving at high speeds. This wasn't even high speed, really. It really wasn't. But for them, they thought it was, you know, going super fast. And I mean, overall, I think it was funny. He laughs now, and everybody has a good time. You know, everybody had a good experience that day.
Well, it's good to see not only two brothers, but two fighters out of their element, so to speak, and just having some fun there. Wouldn't you agree?
Yeah, I mean, just to do something different, you know, like who really has an opportunity to ride a Lamborghini Aventador, you know, that often? I mean, not many people. And if you do, I mean, it's maybe under controlled, you know, you can't really speed up, or you know, maybe it's a little ride as a passenger around the block, but you really can't go fast in the street.
Right.
Also, that day, I mean, it's my own private house up there, big old driveway there, private road. So I didn't even tell him to go to the track with me, but he'll never go. He'll never. He says he'll never go on the track with me, because at the track it is obviously faster speeds,
made
for that. So that day at the, you know, my house, I think it was fun. You know, it's like little brother, you know, bonding time. And just outside of the normal, you know, daily routine that he has, you know, at the gym and, you know, regular cars. I mean, my sisters, same thing. I got them to get on the car. And, I mean, they probably were scared during that time. But then afterwards, they're all laughing about it. They're all asking me for the video because they want to share with their kids. And, you know, it's fun. I mean, like I said, it's something different, but in a fun, safe way.
Talking about fun and talking about opportunity in a big event, let's talk about May 22nd. Iron Sharpens Iron, your stablemate, your teammate, Jose Ramirez, for all the marbles, taking on Josh Taylor. What's your take on this big event, and how do you think Jose will react to that first ballerine?
I think it's a great fight. I think the fans are really in for a huge treat. You know, you don't see fights like that often where all the belts are on the line. You know, Jose holds two of the belts at 140. He holds the WBC and the WBO title. Taylor holding the IBF and the WBA title on 140. And they're fighting each other. You know, it's a great matchup. So for boxing purposes, it's a great, great matchup. And then for us, you know, he's my teammate here, you know, family here at RGBA. You know, it's a great fight for us as well, you know, and I say myself, I include myself because we're part of the same team. We basically represent each other. I did a few rounds of sparring the other day with him. You know, I sparred with him before in the past. I look forward to helping him if I can. You know, I'll get in the ring, finish a couple rounds if he needs it. You know, if his sparring partners are, you know, two or three sparring partners and he needs a couple extra rounds, you know, I'll fill in. Because I want to make sure that we have the best Jose Ramirez.
Absolutely.
On fight night, you know. I think he has a great opportunity in front of him, you know, to hold all the belts and be, you know, regarded as one of the very best pound for pound fighters, you know, in this day. That victory would do that for him. Josh Taylor's no easy opponent. It's a difficult opponent. Smart fighter, technical fighter, southpaw stance, which can complicate things. But I really believe in Jose. I mean, I spar with him, and the strength that he has, the determination, the aggression, you know, that pressure that he brings every night, it's like relentless. You know, you just can't back off, can't back him off. So I think that's what he's gonna have in his favor, and I'm looking forward to the fight. You know, I'll be there supporting Jose, and I think you know, we bring the win. I think we bring the belts home. I think Jose brings all the belts home, and he's gonna be, you know, on another level now.
This is coming from a four division world champion. So if anybody knows what an opportunity is and how to capitalize that, it's Mikey Garcia. And Mikey, I know you've been chasing that fifth division.
Sure.
When can the fans look forward to you getting that opportunity? I know we're waiting for paperwork or whatever the details get finalized. If the Manny Pacquiao fight doesn't happen, are you willing to take a non-title fight before getting another opportunity at a fifth championship?
Yeah, most definitely. I want to be back sometime in this summer, like June, maybe July. We've been trying to get this fight with Manny, but if it doesn't happen, I'm open to fight somebody else. I still want to campaign at 47 right now for the time being. You know, I'm looking for a fifth division world title. And at the same time, I'm also going to wait to see how Jose, you know, what he decides to do. If he decides to stay at 140 or maybe move up,
right,
at that time maybe some of the titles become vacant, and then I can come down to 40. You know, right now there's really nothing for me at 40. You know, they're holding the belts. I can't secure any title fights at 40, so what's the reason for me to fight at 40? So that's why I'm at 47, trying to campaign at 47. But I'm open to fight other guys at 47 if the Pacquiao fight doesn't come to fruition. Like I said, you know, that fifth division world title is what's on my mind first.
You know, I'm gonna let you go, but I gotta ask you this last question. I shared with your brother a possibly exhibition, you know, at times it came out of my mouth, a possible fight. I mentioned Hector Macho Camacho Jr. After June 19th, but another name came, I just got a text a little earlier, a possibility he'd love to share the ring with your brother, and that's Michael Carbajal. Sure. What's your take on that, on an exhibition, Robert Garcia versus Michael Carbajal?
Yeah, I like Michael. I remember him, I've seen him, I was obviously a little kid, but I remember seeing him, and I've seen obviously a lot of video. He was one hell of a fighter, man. One hell of a fighter, beautiful 1-2, right hand, just beautiful. And I mean, if they're interested in doing some kind of exhibition, you know, maybe some sort of fundraiser happens, or maybe it's a full night of exhibition matches that nice. Will host a fundraiser event. You know, I'm all for something like that, you know. And boxers always miss it, you know. You know, there's that's why there's so much interest right now with these exhibitions, you know, coming along. I think Michael Carbajal was one of the, you know, greatest fighters in the lower divisions. If he decided to come back, you know, as in an exhibition with my brother, I mean, I think that would be pretty fun too. And the fans seem to accept it right now. They're accepting these exhibitions because they miss the old fighters as well. They miss seeing them. And if they can come back for a night and have fun with it, and everybody knows that it's for good cause, or it's good entertainment, you know, where you get to see some of your favorite fighters back in the ring, that's fun. I mean, I'm okay with that. I personally don't agree with trying to, in a way, lie to the fans, making them believe it's gonna be a fight. It's not a fight, and that's why everybody claims it's an exhibition. You gotta understand that. You know, the fight, the fans need to understand that it's only an exhibition. Don't expect this to be a fight.
Yes.
So I heard some people getting disappointed. Oh, but, you know, they're not even hitting each other hard. Dude, it's an exhibition. Exactly. Relax, you know. Commission won't sanction a no. fight. You know, it's not a fight. It's an exhibition. Let them have fun. And you guys should know that it's that. And if the fans accept it, then go for it, you know. That'd be pretty fun. Like I said, I'll even be part of an exhibition if it's a good fundraiser. We did one a few years back with Eric Morales here.
Yeah.
We did one here. You know, it was a fundraiser for my boy Isaac Olunga. You know, so why not? You know, I'm all for that. And if it does happen, I mean, I think Robert needs to get back in shape because he hasn't been in the gym that much. But I saw him working out last week, so maybe that's signs that he is actually looking into maybe getting back.
Well, Mikey, maybe he knows something we don't know. I knew only Mikey and time can tell. Hey, it's a wrap here. Robert Garcia's Boxing Academy with the 4-division, soon to be 5-division world champion, Mikey Garcia, and it's a wrap. Thumbs up for Richie.
Hey guys, this is Mikey Garcia, and I'm here with the Fighter's Voice.
Don't miss out. Now you can listen to the Fighter's Voice podcast radio show on Spotify, iHeartRadio, Apple Podcasts, TuneIn Radio. New show, new topics, new look, bringing you the latest news. Every fighter has a voice, and so do you. For the hottest and latest in sports and entertainment, exclusive interviews with the biggest names in the sport of boxing and MMA.
I'm Robert Garcia.
I'm Jose Ramirez.
Hey guys, this is Mikey Garcia, and I'm here with
the Fighter's Voice.